Like Dr. Arvind Gupta said, I have been working with him and I know one thing for sure. He himself sticks to the time and expects everyone else to stick to the time. And when we worked with him, all our projects we were able to deliver, I think, well ahead of time. And so that is one challenge for me, but I'll try and keep it. While I'm going to speak about the topic which has been assigned to me, these are my personal views and based on the experience that I have gained. And in terms of being a regional superpower and the aspirations to be providing regional stability, what is most important for us to understand is that we should not try and compare a model which is existing, that is what America is able to do today. It hasn't happened overnight. And if India is to start providing stability and security in the region, baby steps will have to be taken. And the focus in this particular gathering is to take a stock of what have we done so far, and then thereafter possibly look at what is wrong, what needs to be done. While in trying to do so as to what is wrong and what needs to be done, there is only up to a particular point that you can speak in the open. The rest of it, I'm sure, and we've been a part of the system, that there are a large number of people who are very silently, steadily working towards that, and that need not be unnecessarily flashed all around, because then that creates the problem and more complication in trying to do damage control in the region. Now, what should we look at? So, because we have to see what this government has done, so 2014, the Prime Minister very clearly made his mind clear. In the first interaction itself, in the oath-taking ceremony, he had the heads of state from the SAARC countries here. So he was not looking only inwardly towards the country, he was looking in the region. And then, while discussing with the diplomats, he made his intention clear by saying that the diplomacy and the comprehensive national power, the Indian position has to be taking the form of a leading role rather than just being a balancing force. I think that was an important point which he said, and within no time, the Act East intention of his was also made public. Thereafter, we found, and very logically, the Foreign Secretary Dr. Jaishankar also made a mention that this is an indication of India's growing self-confidence and declaring that the country now aspires to be a leading power rather than just a balancing power. So when we look at the intention of the country that it has to be a regional stability provider, security provider, what does a country need? What does a nation need? How do you become a regional stability provider? You have to have an economic might. You have to have military power. And when I say military power, it is in terms of conventional as well as the strategic capability that you have. And in strategic capability, there are some means which are kinetic, there are some means which are non-kinetic. The country also has to have some military means as well as non-military means. So that is another issue which is required to become a force to be recognized. Diplomatic acumen, the agility, the vision, all those things are required. And most important is the strong political will which was displayed. Externally, we definitely need the support, and there comes the strategic partnerships. So all in all, when we start doing bean counting as to what all has happened, Indian economy has been steadily growing, may not be at the miraculous figures as declared by China over a sustained period of 2.5 decades, but we definitely have been able to survive the various ups and downs in the global market, and we have been steadily growing. Figures actually do not matter, the direction matters, and the capability to deliver goods over a sustained period, that is what matters. The various procedures and processes that have been corrected, and in the last couple of years, the ease of doing business, these are all indicators that the intention and the direction is moving correctly. In terms of military issues, what is it that has been done? So military diplomacy and the overall diplomacy, these have to go hand in hand. Whenever the Prime Minister and the other ministers have been visiting the countries in the region, and when I say region, I am going and taking the Indian Ocean region also, so there has been enhanced defence cooperation. There has been a lot of progress that has been made during the visits with Seychelles, with Mauritius. The kind of impact that has been felt, the kind of footprint that has been established, the way the government has been able to get a kind of collaborative move ahead between India, Sri Lanka, Maldives, Mauritius, Seychelles. Earlier also there were intentions displayed, but there was hardly any progress, and especially while dealing with Sri Lanka, there used to be a lot of problems dictated by internal compulsions. But during one of the visits, again, there has been progress made where there has been a formal declaration and there has been a clear intent displayed that India stands by the unity and integrity of Sri Lanka. But at the same time, the message has been sent that whatever rights and whatever logical aspirations that the Indian origin people have should be met. Now, what does that show? That shows that there is an intent to have the region going along with you, as also to keep the interests of the Indian origin people intact. And that is a message internally also, that internal politics would not hold hostage your foreign policy. A large number of coastal radar systems have been promised, installed, and are still being installed in the neighborhood as well as even along the coast of Africa. There's a lot of emphasis which is being given to this region, in particular right up to South Africa, Mozambique, that is what is being done. When you look towards Act East intention of the government, what better than the kind of display that you saw on 26 January when all the heads of the state were present? That is a very loud and clear signal. So far, whenever there was interaction with ASEAN countries at various levels, including my level, we always found our counterparts telling us like, look, please understand what is the kind of compulsion on us to abide by the China's diktat. But subsequently, a number of things which have happened, and they always used to say, India has to do a little more. India has done that little more, and there is a kind of interest that has got aroused among these countries that India is a good country to deal with. Another positive thing which one has been able to say is the dexterity, the agility of the Indian foreign policy, and which is admired by a large number of diplomats all over the world. The ambassadors are here. I take the liberty of speaking on behalf of the Ministry of External Affairs, again, based on my own experience. A large number of our counterparts used to say that we admire the way India handles the countries in the neighborhood as well as outside. There may be adversarial relations between them, but India is on an equal footing with all of them. Whether you are looking at Israel and Palestine, or you're looking at Israel and Iran, or whether you're looking at Iran and Saudi Arabia, we are able to deal with them at a level where only a matured nation and a nation which is taken seriously, we have been able to deal with them. And that is something which is very important, because the credibility and image of a country is the only thing which matters when the region starts trusting you. Not only in the region, we have been able to balance and carry out a military exercise with the United States and in the same time with Russia. So that is an extremely good mark that we've been able to deal with. The Americans are extremely interested in India taking over this responsibility, and towards that extent, I think we have made the initial progress in dealing with the United States, Japan, Australia, and moving ahead towards the assuming the role of regional stability provider. It's very clear, it's no longer fence sitting. India is taking decisive steps and it is signaling also. And when we look at whatever has been done so far, simultaneously we also have to look at the challenges. While I said that the political will is there, the military might has to keep pace, there are very serious challenges in terms of the delays of the procurement, in terms of what has been our capability of manufacturing in-house has been far from satisfactory, but subsequently there has been tremendous amount of move to get the capability at home. But the processes, the attitude, the work culture, that leaves a lot to be desired. So the infrastructure, the establishments which are the strategic assets of the country to improve the military might have to now convert the attitude to being strategic assets rather than just job opportunities or populist measures. So I am specifically talking of the industry, especially the government industry, because the private sector obviously would move much faster because they are more agile. Pakistan and China have been the real challenges for Indian aspirations, and everything possible has been done, is being done and will be done to ensure that our progress in achieving this stature is delayed and derailed. So starting from skirmishes, transgressions, the terrorism export, the nuclear blackmail, playing of the Islamic card, the kind of stalling of SAARC and playing down the image of India, and then the CPC and the Rowdy corridor, all these are in a way trying to derail the process where India becomes a stability provider in the region. However, that does not derail so easily. So when you talk of Gwadar, you talk of Chabar simultaneously. When you talk of CPC, you talk of the North-South corridor also. So we have good responses, but unfortunately, whatever little lacks is in terms of the fineness and the promptness of delivery of our promises. One of the most important issues, which was the signaling, was the resolve and resilience India displayed during the Doklam crisis, where from mid-June 17 to August 17, India very silently and very firmly stood its ground, and giving a lot of nervous days to China, especially prior to the BRICS summit. The hysteria that was displayed by the Chinese media was evident that what we were doing was right. The Indian achievements, these are just baby steps. I think what we need to do is to develop further. But what is extremely important and where I want to round off is that this is a national vision, this is a national commitment, this is a national dream for the subsequent generations. And this is not the only responsibility or the responsibility only of the establishment. I think each and every citizen, each and every person in this has to be involved. And those, especially in the government, have to ensure that the processes, procedures and the deliveries ensure that this national vision is met with. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Thank you very much.